in collaboration with Ms. Renata Bernard, who is a communication expert. And we invited her back because of the phenomenal work that she has done with our ULA students in the past. And so we said, hey, why not do something a little bit different to inspire our students? And she is going to specifically focus on helping students to maximize their communication and leadership skills. How about that? I know I can. So I'm going to be taking some notes on the side as well, right? So before we get started, we're definitely going to have an opportunity to interact. We have a lot of great and wonderful faculty and staff in the room. By the way, I would love to acknowledge you all. So if faculty and staff, thank you all for coming. I would like you to stand up one by one and just say your name and which department you're from so that our students can get to know exactly who's in the room.
Hey everyone, I'm Mona John.
Latino studies, Caribbean studies, this kind of thing. I'm also on the Senate executive, among other responsibilities.
Hi, my name is Rebecca Curry. I'm the Assistant Director of Diversity Outreach and Recruitment of the Advisor to the Boston Student Association, CHICHA.
Alrighty, do we have any other faculty?
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Alpha Law, and I work with the Center for Teaching and Learning.
I don't know if I say my name for those of you who are new to the BMI. My name is Rebecca Quayle, and I serve as a seat counselor as well as one of the BMI administrators here on the Berea College campus. So, before we transition, for my colleague Andrew and Marisol, who's going to explain also, assist me and explain a little bit more about what today is going to consist of and the BMI as a whole, I just want to talk a little bit about the mission of the BMI and why it exists. And I know that we have some current ULA BMI students here, so I'm going to ask for some audience participation. So who would like to assist me in helping those who are new to the BMI? Tell us a little bit about the mission of the BMI. What do you know about it? Yes.
Hi everyone, my name is Lewis, current undergraduate student here. You said, what is the mission of BMI? Well, what I know and being part of BMLA, it's to get Black and Latino students, not only to get them to college, but also increase their retention rate. You know, it's not just about getting students to college. A lot of students, whatever happens, you know, in their personal life or whatever case may be, they tend to not continue higher education, and you know that has become one of the problems within our community. So BMI tries to work with students and really enhance their capabilities and you know what they're capable of. So.
Absolutely.
Give
them a round of applause. Anybody else? Thank you. Anybody else
want to
add to that? Yes.
Hello, my name is Ramon DeLeo. In addition to what Lewis said, I would also say that the BMI does not only serves as a way to just increase number of representation and success for Black and Latinos, but also offer them a roadmap and variety of other resources that they otherwise wouldn't be able to get a hold of anywhere else. So basically boost their confidence, chances, and capabilities to actually be successful beyond college.
Absolutely. Thank you.
Do
we have one more?
Yeah, I wrote to ensure the success and foster leadership within the Black and Latino community as well as others, other minorities.
Absolutely, thank you. Thank you for the brave song, being courageous and sharing that. Absolutely. So just to add to that, the mission, BMI started back in 2004 with the mission and vision of creating access and opportunity for young men of color, specifically, to, of course, enter higher education, to retain them, as you mentioned, and also to make sure that they are provided with the necessary resources to graduate, right? So, of course, through the years, it has evolved, and we do not only focus on young men, but we have young women that are involved, right, West in the house?
Woo!
West Downstate Women Office Success. So we provide an array of services, and it's not just open to males. It's open to, and also just, not open to just males, but it's open to everyone in the college. So if you're feeling like, if you're new to the BMI, and you want a community, and you you're just not sure, okay, I don't know what club to join. I'm not quite sure if I fit in any particular community. The BMI is open to you, right? Regardless of race, ethnicity, or gender. So it's important to keep that in mind, and we welcome you all. All right, so now I would like to pass the floor on to my colleague, Andrew, who's gonna give you a little bit more details about what the BMI is up to for this spring semester.
Right.
Let's give Andrew a round of applause.
So, good afternoon, Andrew Lofton, UC counselor, also the director of the Urban Male Leadership Academy Scholars Program here. So, wanting to just add, and thank you all for your responses. So, the purpose of the BMI is to really support you all in the learning that you can continue outside of the classroom. So, you may have been used to high school and the way you go to class, do your homework, and that's it. In college, it's different. Some of the upperclassmen know it. Some of the underclassmen may be learning it right now, and that there's a lot of things for you to experience that come outside of your class period. So that's why we have some of the faculty and administrators here and using them as resources to be able to say, hey, what is it that you teach? What is the office that you work in? I'm contemplating this career. I've met with many of you and had conversations at length about what, I don't know if I want to be here. I'm here, I'm trying to figure out how to stay here. I'm here and struggling and I need help, or I know exactly what I want to do. Who can I get connected to? So in the BMI, we are looking to say, how can we more personalize your experience here at Brook College? So that is why this is important that you spread the word and that you be able to share your experiences like you are gonna be able to do today. So on March 17th is our next event that is gonna be transitioning to college. So again, we're looking to say, how do we continue to have conversations in smaller group settings where you can really process what's going on and figure out how you're going to be here. There's also an event I skipped a little bit on February 27th that Wes is having. Yes, let's talk about it. So yes, So again, in celebration of Black History Month and also again deepening your learning, you'll have an opportunity to come together in a group of both students, faculty, staff, administrators to have further conversations. And then I'll say a few, let me do them all. Okay. Then on March 13th is gonna be the CUNY Creative Arts Team. I hate school, but love to learn. So knowing, can anyone resonate with that? Yes, yes. I did too for a long time. It took me 8 years to go back to get my master's degree because I felt that way. And again, it's a way to figure out, well, how do I negotiate? How do I negotiate this? And then, is that the last one?
Yep, that's the last one.
That's the last one. So again, stay tuned on the listserv. Also, many of us, in the spirit, again, of connecting on a more individual basis, will be posting on the website office hours. So these are gonna be open times where students can come and speak to us about whatever is going on with them. So again, it's just a way for you to know I have a place to go and someone to talk to here on campus, all right? All right. I'm sorry, Marisol is gonna speak next.
Tell us how, if you enjoyed our program, and I'm going to put it on the screen for 1 second just so you can see what our survey looks like if I can. This is just a little survey that we're going to have you can take at the end. It's just going to give us your name and what year you are in the college, and also if you're part of any club and what you thought of our event. So at the end of the program, we're going to put the link on the screen, and we hope that you guys can take the survey in here. Do not leave without taking the survey. Thank you. And now I'm going to introduce Rebecca again, who will introduce Renata.
Thank you, Marisol.
One thing to add to the survey. So I know that you all may feel surveyed out. Does anyone feel surveyed out? Okay. Do know, we do read them. We do read them. Many of the people in here send out surveys and read the surveys, because what we hear on one end is, how come you all don't do this? Well, how come you didn't tell me? And then it's just like, and knowing that it takes time, we just can't snap our fingers and do something. It takes time and effort, which is what we're hoping to be able to get it done, but we need your feedback. So again, we try to make them brief. We try to make them brief, and we do read them. So please know that we're going to be looking at these next week. All right.
Absolutely. And like Andrew mentioned, this is a great opportunity for us to continue to provide workshops and opportunities to support you. So we want to hear from you. All right. And so the moment of time that we've been waiting for, I'm not going to read a brief bio. Renata Bernard, our guest presenter. Renata Bernard is an instructional designer and communications professional with over 20 years of leadership and training development experience. With professional experience spanning multiple industries and roles, her commitment to improving communication strategies and skills stay constant. With her unique approach to designing hands-on experience and leadership exercises, Renata has left her mark as a memorable go-to instructor and facilitator for communication development. So ladies and gentlemen, let's all give a round of applause for Renata Bernard.
Thank you. Thank you very much. This is great energy. You guys are already in it, which is awesome. As she mentioned, my name is Renata. I'm so grateful to be back in Baruch. Love this place. In fact, I was actually met Dr. Anselmo years ago when she was designing UMLA and creating that entire program, BMI, all of the wonderful programs that have come and stem from it. So I am just over the moon to be back with all of you. So it looks like we have about an hour to discuss like my favorite thing in all the world, which is leadership communication. I'm gonna try and find my, okay, awesome, even better. Find my project here so I can talk about it. Yeah. Thank you. Yes, leading the way with communication. I'm an admitted communication junkie. That makes me a nerd about it. So I'm not gonna talk to you, I'm actually just gonna be more a facilitator today, if that's okay. I like to have you all talk to each other, which I think is much more impactful and relevant. But we are gonna talk about leadership and communication today, how you kind of use communication to become a better leader, how it affects your leadership, right? And why it even matters, why it's important. Can't actually start talking about it without, and I'm sorry, and this is the question we're actually going to try and answer today, all right, which is, what impact does communication have on leadership? Anybody have just a guess at this moment? What impact do you think communication has?
You must use communication in order to communicate with others, your plans and your goals, to become a leader, uh-huh, and to get other people to follow you and do what you say, uh-huh, in a respectful way.
Aha. Uh-huh. I like that respectful piece that she added there. Yeah, right. What else?
Sorry. I think when it comes to like leadership, communication is like the biggest thing, because communication is not only what you say verbally, but non-verbally as well.
Ooh, good. See, we're already getting into it. Yes.
Communication is important because you want all the people that follow you to literally like be clarified and be on the same page of what's going on, whether it be a project, an essay, or just overall like any kind of project that you have to work on.
Yes.
And if no one is on the same page, then it just gets chaotic. And it will be more work to get everyone together than just like simply clarifying what you want something done.
You sound like you speak from
powerful
experience. Right? As if maybe it's happened, something chaotic has happened to you.
Yeah, learned it the hard way.
Yeah. Often we do, right? This is how we kind of get to understanding what communication styles work, you know, what languaging works with people, right? This is how we kind of get to that, is because we find ourselves in the midst of chaos and we're like, this is not working, right? Yeah, one more.
Yeah, when you properly communicate and are truly understood, I think people are more inclined to follow.
I like that. Great. So let's talk about the role of communication versus language, really briefly. Communication, the imparting or exchange of thoughts, opinions, or information by speech, writing, or signs. Does that resonate with anybody? Mm-hmm. Sorta. It's very wordy, right? In terms of like basically what is communication, it's pretty much everything that you do all the time, without nonstop. In fact, is there a way that you could stop communicating?
No.
You die.
Not at all.
No.
Sleep. What are you communicating?
That you're tired.
I'm tired.
You're not disturbed.
Exactly. Is there a time that you stop communicating?
Not at all.
No.
And some people would argue that even when you're dead, you could still communicate if you ever wrote anything down.
Unless a gold wants you.
If you wrote something down, if you wrote something down with language, it actually can live beyond you. Right? There's authors. If you write something using language, it can actually live beyond you, right? And it's still a mode of communication. Let's talk about language specifically. This is another really wordy thing. I put these up here because I really don't like the definitions at all. It doesn't really speak to kind of like what it is we know it to be. Language, any set or system of such symbols as used in a more or less uniform fashion by blah, 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 right? That's how I feel about it anyway. What is language? And how is it different from communication? Yeah.
Language is the tool you use to communicate?
Yes. It's the words. It's the words. Okay? So a lot of times people think that communicating is using only language. It's not. We've already established that, right? There's lots of nonverbal ways that without language that we can actually communicate. But the language is a tool that we use, okay, in order to communicate. So I just want to clarify that right off the bat because it is important, especially when we're talking about leadership, that your language is precise, that it is clear, that it people can relate to it. But it's not the only thing that's tied into communication, okay? There's two types. This one we talked about, verbal. And I want to just clarify here with verbal that it doesn't mean spoken only. Okay? Because anytime that you use language, which we just discussed, it's a verbal communication. So written things are actual verbal communication. Okay, a lot of times people get that confused. They think verbal is because I have to voice it, right? Or say it, but it's not. It's all things that are written or using language as well. Okay? So what's the other type?
Nonverbal.
Yeah. And what is nonverbal?
Signs.
Yeah, it's pretty much everything else. It's literally everything outside of language. Everything. I have here paralanguage, self-presentation, body language, artifacts, proxemics, and much, much more. It's literally all the other things. I have a little number up here I'm going to show you. What percentage of messaging do you think is delivered nonverbally?
99%.
99%. Nonverbal.
Yeah.
Hi, I'm hearing high numbers.
90, 50, 90, 100%,
no fun. Over 95% of what you communicate is done non-verbally, your messaging. It's pretty impactful, right? Pretty impactful. It's very rarely is it the words that you're saying, it's how you're saying it. Okay? Have you heard that before? Has anybody heard that before? It's not what you said, it's how you said it. Right? Yes. Because that's where the messaging really is delivered. Okay? Good. We're going to do this very short and sweet. It looks really convoluted, but we're going to talk about the process of communication in general, because if you don't understand that there is a process that's happening, then you're going to miss all the places where you can improve. Okay? Well, most people think that you say something, somebody hears it, and that I communicate it, right? And there's actually a whole bunch of things that are going on when you do that. So somebody shout out something that you read on the screen here and tell me what you think it is. Just shout out a word.
Decode.
Encode. What is the encode?
Decode.
Oh, decode. Great. Even better. What's decode?
Decode. So you basically just received the message and now you're trying to figure out what it really means.
Okay. I got it. Trying to figure it out. Yes?
Well, encode is like you kind of like plant the message.
Say it again?
Encode. Like kind of like planting, or I guess we
encoding is done by whom? Who does the encode?
The source.
The source is doing the encode, and the source basically says, I got something up here that I want to communicate. And the encoding process is taking that, which is up here, and translating it into something that you think someone will understand, right? And putting it in a way that you can deliver a message. That is the encode. Very good. What else is up here? Yes?
Response.
Response. What do you think the response is?
It's like the action you take after hearing or reading what you just read, so the action taken upon.
Good. Okay. Excellent. Kind of clean there. And then in this feedback loop, what is this then, do you think?
That is like that action is feedback to the source saying whether or not they got the intended the intended message, basically.
Yes, that's exactly right. Your feedback is basically messaging to your source to let you know as the receiver, I got it, or I completely missed it, right? I didn't get it. Could be anything on the spectrum related to that, okay? What else is on here?
Noise.
Say it again?
Noise.
Noise, yeah. What is the noise?
Anything else that's going on? It's something that could delay you understanding the message or hearing the message.
Very good. Is it external?
Well, it could be external.
It could be external. It could be internal. What's an example of internal noise?
If you're going through something and you're thinking a lot, and someone's trying to talk to you, you might not be focusing on what they're saying because you're going through something.
Very good. Very good. You could just be hungry.
That is true.
I mean, that's internal noise. You're like, dang, my belly is rumbling right now. I can't really focus, right? Or pay attention to what somebody's telling me if there's something else going on, right? And it's as well as external noises. If something's too loud or something's annoying you as a sound, that also counts as well. Very good. I see a couple other things here. What else?
Oh,
yeah, I heard it. Yes. Fields of experience. What in the world? What is that? What are your fields of experience?
Yeah.
Basically our whole life, so school, our job, church, everything.
It's basically everything. It's basically your whole life. It's basically when you walk up and to interchange or interact or communicate with another person, you bring your whole life with you. Guess what? They bring it too. And then you see where they're supposed to interact there? You see how these little circles are supposed to kind of meet out here in the middle?
Nope.
And what happens right here?
Message.
Yeah, that's where the message lives. In the midst of all of these things going on. Yeah, we didn't even talk about the channel community. What's the channel?
The way, the method.
The method, that you use. So if I'm speaking to you face to face, if I'm texting you, if it's an email, if it's a phone call, right? The channel. So in the midst of all of this, we really think that this person has a thought, puts it in a message, and that this person is gonna get it? You see how we tend to simplify things that are very, very, very complex? It's a really complex process. Where do you think that the common breakdowns occur here? Like breakdowns. I mean, unless we're always successful with exactly delivering the message we intend. Yeah, what happened? Where do you think this breaks down a lot?
Decode.
Decode, I heard. Why? Who said it? Decode.
Right there.
Why? Why do you think it breaks down there?
Because sometimes a person might not, depending on their field of experience, what you say might mean something and they might interpret it differently to what you intended.
And that, ladies and gentlemen, is what we call a mic drop, right there. It is exactly accurate. Because in the midst of all of this, I come with my life, and something that you say may hit me totally different than what your intended meaning was. Does that happen to anybody here? Oh, imagine that. Once or twice, right? Yeah, what else?
So I have a question. So if we think about that everyone has its own subjective reality. So when we're communicating, in essence, you're saying that we can't really communicate efficiently because we all have our own reality.
Well, is it true? Are you able to communicate effectively?
Yeah.
Well, then you've answered your question. There are ways that we can do this. There are strategies that we can use to be better and become more proficient at getting our intended encoding, our intended message, our intended meaning across other people. And that is actually the work that's of leaders, right? That is actually what they're doing. That is actually, they just become a little bit better in being very clear in the message that they want to deliver. And that's why I share this with you. Because it does seem like when you're looking at this, you're like, how in the world can I ever get my meaning across? There's a lot of stuff here. But just because it's a complex process doesn't mean we can't improve it and find strategies through it. Okay, so thank you for your question. It's really important. And that's exactly why I put this up here. That was the exact intent of it. Yeah.
Well, what would you say has, like, I mean, of course, when you're communicating, it's never a case of power, but, like, who do you think has, or who would you say has more power, like the speaker or the listener?
And it's always a case of power, by the way. There's power in every single interaction that you have. Someone has it and someone does not, or is offering not to have it, right? And it really depends on the motivation of both as to who has it. And it rotates a lot. And I actually do a whole semester course on this work, so we can really get into it. We're not going to right now. It's a very excellent question. But there is definitely power in every communication exchange that you have, every single one. Yep, very good. All right. We're going to do an exercise because I'm talking way too much up here. Now, this is actually great for everyone to participate, and I look directly at the faculty and staff as well. Because really, I mean, all of you can attest that we all need to improve on this. There's really no, I love when, you know, she called me a communication expert. I'm like, yeah, sure. I get it right every time. No, it's not how it works, right? We're always constantly working on this and improving this. So I encourage you all to engage as well. But what I need you to do right now is get up with a partner, okay? Just sit, whoever you're sitting right next to, you need to have somebody to actually talk to, okay? Introduce yourself if you don't know that person. And when you have a partner, or if you don't have a partner, let me know, because we have maybe some singles. Raise your hand if you do not. Does everybody have a partner? You guys gonna partner up? Are you good? He's moving up. Okay. You're going to have to determine who's A and who's B. Okay. This is not the exercise, by the way. A and the B. Okay, you got it. Everybody knows who's A and who's B, right? Okay, now what I want you to do is I want you to think for about 30 seconds on something that you are really passionate about. Something that if given the opportunity, you could talk literally for hours about. Okay, it can be anything. Whatever that thing is for you, something that you're super passionate about. Okay, ready, set, go. And most of you probably have it, yes? Got it?
Yes.
Okay. So what we're going to do, A's, raise your hand if you're an A. A, what you're going to do is you're going to turn to B and you are going to talk to B about that thing that you are most passionate about. That thing, like I said, if you were just going to be able to have a platform to just go on about it, you could do it, right? I'm not going to give you a ton of time, but you are going to have this couple minutes, maybe a minute, to just share with them what that thing you're most passionate about, okay? B's. You are going going to do everything in your power to ignore this person. You are going to work to ignore this person. Outside of getting up and walking away, please don't do that, that's rude. Okay? But you are going to ignore this person as much as you possibly can. Are there any questions? On your mark, get set, go.
So, in order, I'm like, you know what, I need to get home. As I was heading home, I walked by this lobster. I walked by this lobster. And that's all they if I can get into the dream, if I can get inside this dream, I'm good.
Three times. Bees! Now it's your turn to talk about that thing that you're oh so passionate about and A's. Ooh, is it gonna feel so good? It's gonna feel so good to work to ignore these people. So bees, now you get to talk to A, and A's, you know what to do. Okay, go.
Explain what I'm trying to say, but knowing that it's just a waste of time. time actually kind of hurts.
Yeah, it does, right? You're kind of like, I am just wasting my gosh darn time right now, right? What am I doing? Who else as a speaker?
I was stuck on what to say because he was like looking at his nails, and then he decided to look at Lewis back there, what he was talking about. I said, oh, maybe his conversation is more interesting.
Yeah.
It was. He was saying something good.
Okay. Very good. Very good. Now, how was it as the listener?
It's pretty easy.
It was easy.
I felt bad. I'm fine.
It was easy.
No, it was a bit hard.
Easy to ignore.
It was hard. So sometimes, for some people, this is what you get, right? As a listener, it varies. So I heard it's easy, and then I heard it's hard.
I had a really hard time ignoring. I'm just not wired that way.
Yeah.
I was trying, but I couldn't help but kind of being engaged, even though I was literally trying to. I couldn't make that work.
Right. And that's often one of the things that's why I say try to, because for some people it's very difficult. I think there's a generational gap here. I'm just going to speak to it, because a lot of our millennials and things are used to not fully paying attention a lot of the times. They're used to kind of being distracted with other things, and so ignoring somebody or kind of hearing something in the background is like very normal. Yeah. I did see a lot of phones come out. That's going to be the most, the easiest way, right, to really ignore somebody would be to distract yourself with something else. Right. Okay. So how do you think that this impacts the people that you actually care about? The people that really have something that they're very passionate about and want to share with you? Yes, so before you answer, what we're going to do again is you're going to be with your A and your B. And this time, B's are going to start. B's, you get to share now again, talk about that thing that you're super passionate about. And A's, you're going to listen as if the words coming out of their mouth are the truth to life. As if it's literal gold that's falling out of their mouth right now, and there's nothing more important than what it is that they have to say. That means there should be no distractions. That means you should actually position yourself and prepare yourself to listen to a person that has the truth to life to share with you. So I'm going to say go in about 10 seconds. And A's, you're going to listen. B's, you're going to share that thing you're most passionate about. On your mark, get set, go.
I'm not a good exerciser. I'm not a big exerciser buff, but I hold the key. So I gave myself 3 months last year, 3 months of just like going hard, intense workout, no distractions, just take life,
I cut myself
here
in my head. I'm like,
a lot of things that people do, I know it's bad, but I'm like, I'm not like, I cut myself off from McDonald's, Chipotle, any of those things that, in my head, I know.
Switch it up, okay? So now, A's, you get to talk about that thing that you're super passionate about. B's, prepare to listen like it matters, like this is gold, like this. this is truth of life. Ready, set, go.
Actually, I have a question for her.
Can I ask her? No. You have to have a conversation after this with her. You can ask all the questions you want.
Okay.
Yeah.
I was flooded with too many ideas. I was like, okay, she's really listening. And then I lost my train of thought. Yeah, because I had so many, so.
Yes, I get this on occasion. Like, you know, sometimes it's like, oh my goodness, I don't even know what to say because someone's actually listening. Like, you know, it's a whole different experience. Because we're so used to being ignored. We're so used to being second thought. So much of the time, then it's like a whole new experience when someone's actually listening. How was it as the listener? How was this as a listener?
I mean, it was a lot easier for me because I was actually interested in what he was talking about, but especially just I've grown up to just be to listen to people and all that. Yeah.
Awesome. Commend your parents. Yes.
I felt connected with what my partner had to say, but and I even learned to like. A little bit something new about what he likes, and it's usually like the Supreme brand, and yeah, I literally learned what Supreme is and how it ties to like people's lifestyles, and I generally did not think about that until then.
Yeah. Awesome. Yes.
Like, I wanted to ask questions, but like I had to hold back because I don't want to be rude and interrupt them since they were like so into it, and like I always want to listen to someone who you know who has something to say and is passionate about. So like I think asking questions while I think it's rude, you know, to do that. So like I was like, okay, let me hold back till the end.
Yeah.
So
yes.
Yeah, to add on what Lewis said, I was more like instead of asking questions, like I'll have like a puzzled face or like I'll make like a quick body language that way the person can know like they need to elaborate or do something. Because I'm really listening.
Very good. So one of the things that is most I think impactful as a listener is how amazing the person who's sharing with you becomes. Just like that. It's like instantly once you start purposely listening to somebody, they're amazing. people sitting next to you right now. And you're like, wow. I mean, right? Like, you're like, yo, this person's awesome. I can't wait to know more or have a longer than that one sentence opportunity to hear about that passion, right? So it's there. It's there. And as soon as you tap into that, you will be amazed by the people you are surrounded with. You will be amazed by the people you are surrounded with if you learn to listen to them. Now, the question I asked is, how do you think your listening impacts the people that matter to you? How many of the people that you actually love and care about are you listening to while you're on your phone? And what's the impact that that has with them? It's not actually a part of the discussion. It's something for you to really consider, right? Because those are the people that matter. And when we're leaders, well, let's talk about being a leader. Let's talk about being a leader a little bit now, because we're still trying to figure out what impact communication has on leadership, right? That's what we're in here for today. So what is a leader? What are some things that define leader? It's not a trick question, I promise. Yeah.
So first thing that comes to mind when it comes, what defines a leader is someone who is willing to take risks. They're literally risk takers.
Awesome. What else? Yes.
They're outspoken. They know how to communicate their ideas to the people much easier so they can understand.
Okay. I think many are like that. Yes. Absolutely.
Someone who can take charge.
Take charge. Got it. Very nice. Yes.
A good listener.
Usually.
Someone who sets a standard.
Okay, very good. I like that.
They're open-minded.
You'd like them to be. Yes.
A leader knows how to take charge, but also know when it's okay to kind of fall back and let other people assume responsibility.
Very good. Yes. What does a leader have to have? Followers!
Oh.
Or minions. Right, little minions? That works too. But you know, if we're going to be leaders, we have to have people that are willing to let us lead, right? You have to have people that are going to let you lead. And in order to lead, you create visions. You create a space where people can step into, and then you can lead them places. Okay? So, what we're gonna talk about are my three eyes. Okay, not literal eyes. eyes as in the letter I, okay? They are, and I'm not gonna talk about them, you guys are gonna talk about them. Integrity. Intention. And invitation. We're going to get into three groups really quickly, and we have three sections, so this should work really nice. So ones are going to be in this section over here, twos are going to kind of group up here, and then threes are going to move over here, okay? We're going to do this quickly because then I'm going to tell you what your activity is going to be. So can we just count off? That's how we'll do it. So you can mix it up.
One.
One.
Two.
Three.
Four.
One. Yeah. Two, yeah.
Three.
One. Three? Okay.
One.
Three.
One.
Are you
no.
Okay.
Three.
One.
Two.
Three? You want to participate?
Sure.
Okay. Betty, one.
Two.
She said, okay. So one's over in that section over there, two's right here, and three's over here. And then I'm going to tell you what you're going to do with this.
Three's over there. Two's.
So then B
be said, imitation is like basically kind of like a hook. Like, how do you get your followers to follow you? Or like how what you mentioned also, how like being approachable and welcoming to others.
Very good.
Yeah.
Did you hear that?
Mm-hmm. No.
No.
Well, stand.
Yeah, maybe you stand.
Hi, my name is Messiah. For invitation, we said, invitation is like, how do you get your followers to kind of like follow you? And then the second definition we came up with is like, how approachable or I guess open you are to others. Yeah, and then we need to go through the three strategies.
Yes, please, we definitely want to hear these strategies.
So the three strategies we came up with, the first one is like let's say if you were doing a presentation or you're writing an essay, that's like the hook. Like, how do you get people to listen to you? And then the second one, we said, what did we say? Anybody help me out?
The second was just, we should be able to talk to them and have like a good conversation with them. We, invite them to what we're trying to do as a leader and the goals of the leader as a whole.
Mm-hmm. We also mentioned, like, let's say if you're in a group and then you see like someone who's like, I don't know, kind of like not speaking or they're quiet, you can ask them like, how are you doing? Or what are your ideas? That's what we came up with.
Awesome.
Thank you.
Inviting, right? We all want our leaders to be inviting and open, because that's how we're much, much more likely. Think of all the things that you follow in. Why? Why do you do it? Oh, because, wow, this person really is warm. They invited me. They created something, right, that I can, like, oh, step into. It's a very important aspect of being a leader. Is providing that invitation for the people that you would like to join you. Okay, very nice. Good work, guys. Group two, intention. What does that mean? Anyone, yes.
Hello there, my name is Jamil DeLeo. And what we talk about with intention is that we define it as a way for someone to establish an action plan and take the necessary first initiative to get someone on board with what their plan is and what are the steps necessary to achieve that goal of the plan.
God, I like that. Very good. How about some strategies?
One of them I said was communication, so you just gotta like let them know that this is what you wanna do. The second one was, clarifying, so being like, instead of like beating around the bush or something, you just tell them like exactly what you're planning on doing and this is basically the benefits or the consequences, stuff like that. And then the third one is being a critical thinker, so then letting that person kind of like make that decision for themselves, and since they were already given basically that plate, they take it in how they want to take it.
Very good. I like that a lot. When we have this, can you tell, let me ask a different question. Can you tell the intention of the leaders that you follow? Yes?
I want to be that rescue. Sophia. She had a great statement on
this. Oh, please.
Fiora, go ahead.
Please.
Good intention, bad intention. You could have been fake.
Okay. No, I was just basing it off of myself. I was saying that when I first read the word, I said that I'm not good with telling whether a person is being honest with me or not. Like, like if their intention is good or if their intention is bad. So I was just saying some people can say something but they don't mean it. Like, so I said fake, but I meant it, like, you know, I don't know a better word to say rather than, okay, so a fake person, you know. But I also said, like, that's where the action part comes in, because actions speak louder than words.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what I was saying. That's it.
Very good. That's really important and impactful, because this is really where word meets action. Word meets action. Because there are so many times where we think we know the intention of somebody until they act. until they start doing it, and then it's like, whoa, that doesn't really align with what you said. Something's off here. When it's clear, it's because their words have met with their actions and their behavior. Very good point. Excellent work. Great job, guys. Last but definitely not least, let me hear about integrity.
So we chose integrity. You said that it's all about the morality and the ethics behind, you know, what you're doing and being true to yourself as well as, you know, your team. You never want to lead a team without being honest with them. Mm-hmm. Then someone said the wholeness.
Yeah, that integrity also takes part in considering that it's the different parts that make up the whole. That you can't have a leader without having followers, and always thinking that, you know, I owe my position to my followers, and making sure you're always true to them and always considering them. It's not always what you want, but, you know, it's what benefits us all as a whole.
Mm-hmm. So important.
Three ways that you said we could implement them. One was like, don't do something that, you know, you, wait, don't make your followers do something that you wouldn't do yourself. So, like, be there yourself. Also, another thing was like, with like companies, if they like money, like, you know, they're making a lot of money, so on, like, being honest to the public, like what they're doing, what, you know, what's going actually behind the scenes, not just saying, for example, like a lot of companies say they go green, but a lot of companies are not going green. So that's one of the things, you know, with companies. So always being honest to the public, you want to know what's going on. And the other thing, like, if it all goes wrong, like, speak to, you know what I'm saying? Like, let's say I'm the leader and I'm like, and like, you guys are all following me and I'm like, oh, we just made a bad decision and we're going downhill kind of thing. And just like keeping that away so that they will hate you. Instead, like, open it up, because the people, like, that will bring out the better self of people and like help you out as a leader. They'll understand that. So that's one of the ways, like, just, like, be honest to you, to your group. So like always in times of chaos, actually that's when the truth matters. So we said that. So yeah.
Wow. That was good. I got it. That's awesome. Yeah. Fantastic. Mm-hmm. Fantastic. What I hear a lot here is honesty, truth, and the importance of that here is really what resonates for us followers, for leaders, right? When they are truthful and demonstrate integrity. Excellent. Excellent. Thank you all very much for sharing that and doing that work. Really all I have left for you is the one question. We're going to move on through this. What are you going to do with what you learned today? Look, you should look around the room, first of all, because you have some high impact people in this room. Just by your engagement, your willingness to be here, the answers and the thoughtfulness with which you participated today, take a look around. These are going to be movers and shakers. So, and already leaders on the campus, I can tell, I know. So what are you going to do with what you learned today?
I think the biggest thing that one could do is definitely share it. And I feel like that's one thing that most people don't understand, that, you know, they leave with this information and just keep it to themselves.
Yes.
But, you know, one just saying it to one person could spread it to three different people. So definitely sharing the word and definitely letting people know, like, look, this is something that you should practice because these are the benefits, or whatever the case may be, but it'll definitely change some lives. So, yeah, just keep it in.
Awesome.
Spread it.
Great.
One thing that I learned today is that I think for the most part I saw myself as a good communicator, but today talking about listening, it made me think that sometimes, like, I'm not very good at listening because I feel like I just don't want to listen to what other people are saying. And what I learned today is that to be a great communicator, you also need to be a great listener. So in essence, I start questioning myself whether I am a good communicator or not. So I do want to work on my listening skills, for one. And two, being in this group, I learned that being a leader, I never heard of this, but being a leader is actually not just leading people, but like being part of that group as well and doing what they're doing. Like, something that Professor said is, don't, you shouldn't tell someone to do something you wouldn't do. And again, it goes back to I saw myself as a leader, but then seeing this definition, I'm like, you know, am I or like not?
You are.
And it's kind of like, those are the two things that I want to work on, listening and integrity. Yeah.
So important that you already recognize you want to work on something, which actually categorizes you as a leader. Because you walk out of here without something to work on, is questionable. It's questionable, but the fact that you already know where you want to go automatically puts you in that group. So I can't wait to see what you're going to do. Can't wait. Anybody else?
One of my classes is psychology classes oriented basically on how you work with others. It's called small group processes. Mm-hmm. And basically the goal of the whole class is to kind of see what kind of a person you are when it comes to doing things in a group. What kind of, are you a leader or are you a follower? Mm-hmm. So most of the stuff I already didn't know, but I know that I could take this and apply it back to the class and kind of see what kind of a leader am I.
Mm-hmm. Because those of you who think you're not a leader, if you find your passion, you will lead. When you find your passion, you will lead, I guarantee it. So even if you think that you are a follower, we all follow, absolutely. But there will be a moment for you to lead. There will be something for you to lead in. And if you bring all of the things we discussed today to that and to your group, you'll be memorable. You'll be someone that people follow, right? And look forward to following. All right, we are at time, so I want to thank you all so much for your participation. There are great things always brewing at Baruch, and I'm just very, very happy. So thank you all very much.
So before we go, remember we had that survey, that lovely survey that we want you to fill out before you leave. We have a lovely survey. And while Marisol is pulling up the survey, we want to, You got internet.
You're going to try this again.
Yes, we're going to try
again.
I promise you. Really quick, it's a real quick survey.
Look, and the link is super easy.
So we're allowing you to pull out your phone.
So sit down, pull out your phones.
Yes. If I can just have your attention very quickly as you pull out your phones, it takes a lot of time and effort to put this together. And because you're going to take this with you and share with other people, we also want you to share with your fellow students, of course, about BMI. I do want to recognize Rebecca for doing a phenomenal job here in and out.
Also want, of course, I could not do this without a phenomenal team, and so I want to also thank Betty, Andrew, and Renata, Marisol, for also always being there as a great support, because you can't do it alone. I don't do it alone, right? We do this together, so I want to thank you all. And also, I want to give a special gift to Renata for being so amazing.
Oh, goodness. Thank you.
Here you go. Thank you for your great presentation today. The students were definitely well engaged, and we thank you again for coming back.
Oh, my pleasure.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
No problem.
You did it?
So really quickly, if you can please support us with filling out this survey. It's really quick.